Hello everyone, welcome to another session of Cancer Talk with Ignite. As you all know, the intent behind running this session is to bring cancer experts on board who can share their knowledge and also some very useful and relevant information for newly diagnosed patients and also caregivers. For our session today, we have Dr. Parag Ingle joining us to give you a brief introduction about Dr. Parag. He is a consultant surgical oncologist working with HCG hospitals in Nagpur and has over 7 years of experience working with cancer patients. With that, I would like to welcome you, Dr. Parag. Thank you so much for taking your time off and joining us. Thank you. Okay. So let's move on with the first question of the interview before we get to the treatment part of cervix cancer. So also in today's session, we would be specifically focusing on cervical cancer and the surgical treatment for cervical cancer. So to start off with, could you please help us understand what are the common symptoms of cervical cancer and what are the risks associated, what are the risk factors associated with it?
Beginning with signs and symptoms for cervical cancer. Cervical cancer usually presents with per-vaginal bleeding. It can be post-coital bleeding, it can be intermenstrual bleeding, or it can be post-menopausal bleeding. So usual symptoms are bleeding per vagina. Sometimes patients may experience dyspareunia, that is painful coitus, is yet another symptom. Or sometimes in advanced cases, when the disease has spread into the abdomen apart from the cervix, they can sometimes present with backache or in severe scenario due to metastatic disease, they can present with symptoms like backache or nodule elsewhere in the neck or in the inguinal region. These are in the advanced cases. The usual symptoms are per vaginal bleeding, which can be intermenstrual bleeding, postcoital bleeding, or postmenopausal bleeding.
Okay.
So these are usually the signs and symptoms. And important causative factors, first and foremost important causative factor for cervical cancer would be human papilloma virus. So it is a sexually transmitted virus and it has been implicated in the causation of cervical cancer. There are various types of human papilloma virus, especially serotype 16, 18 are high-risk serotypes in causation of cervical cancer. Okay. Other risk factors include smoking is one of the risk factors. And since it is a sexually transmitted disease and HPV, especially people who have unsafe sex practices are likely to develop cervical cancer.
Okay. So also there is a common confusion between cervix cancer and uterine cancer. Is that, what are the differences or is it the same?
So cervical cancer, first and foremost thing we need to understand is what is cervix. So cervix is that part of the uterus where the uterus opens into the vagina. Agar Hindi mein bola jaye to garbhashay ke mukh ka cancer. Basically it is part of the uterus which opens into the vagina. It is cervix. So cervical cancer usually arises in the cervix. It has got two parts, ectocervix and endocervix. It can be on the ectocervix or in the endocervix or involving both. While uterine cancer per se, when we say uterine cancer, we are usually dealing with cancers arising from the lining of the uterine cavity. That is, cancers arising from the tissue lining the inner the cavity of the uterus. That is endometrial cancer. Or certain sarcomas which arise from the muscles of the uterus. Okay. So basically uterine cancer would be endometrial cancer or sarcomas arising from the uterus. While cervical cancer is basically tumors arising from the cervical epithelium. The cervix is a part of the uterus where the uterus opens into the vagina. Garbhashay ke mukh ka cancer.
Okay. I think that's very clear now. And in terms of cancer, like you've given a whole bunch of risk factors. Also, is there any sort of a hereditary or a genetic aspect to cervical cancer, just like how we have in breast cancer? Does it also get passed on through the genes?
So, if we look into what is the published literature, the scientific literature, we can say for family members of a patient of cervical cancer, the risk is not very much increased. It is slightly increased, but not very much increased. There is no robust scientific literature published to let us know that cervix is running into families per se. There is a slightly increased risk, but not a very high increased risk in relatives of patients who have cervical cancer.
Okay. And
so it is a slightly higher risk. And for these higher risk patients, there are we would recommend frequent surveillance, in the sense increased frequency of screening for cervical cancer in these patients. We'll come to screening later, but just to tell you, it is basically increased frequency of screening in relatives of patients of cervical cancer.
Yeah, because that was actually leading to my next question, which was, now that we know what are the risk factors and also whether it's genetic or no, what is the kind of screening that a woman needs to undergo on a regular basis to understand, to keep a check on early detection?
So recommended screening is basically cervical pap smear. Basically, it involves taking cells from the cervix and examining those cells in the microscope. In a simple terminology, it is basically taking out cells from the cervix and examining under microscope to find if there are any cancerous or precancerous cells. So it is cervical pap smear testing, and it is recommended from the age of 21 years, once in 3 years.
Okay.
It is recommended once in 3 years from the age of 21.
Okay. Okay.
And another way of testing is HPV testing. So it can be cytology, that is pap smear testing. Along with that, we can do HPV testing, which is called as co-testing.
Okay.
So if we are doing co-testing, the usually prescribed interval for testing is 5 years. Okay. If we are doing only pap smear testing, it is once in 3 years.
Okay. And you mentioned that in case there is a cervical patient, then the relatives might have to do a screening with higher frequency. In those cases,
I would suggest they undergo an annual screening for initial 2 to 3 years. And for if for initial 2 to 3 years, their reports for pap smear screening are negative,
okay,
then we can increase the duration for screening to maybe 3 years again.
Okay. Okay.
Annually, initially, and if negative, then we can increase the duration to 3 years.
Okay. I think that makes sense. Because if there are any cervical cancer patients in your family, then an annual pap smear test would be definitely beneficial. And
yeah, initially, maybe annually. After that, once all the 3 annual tests are negative, then we may shift back again to once in 3 years.
Okay, okay, okay. Fair enough. And moving on to the treatment part of it, for this session, we are focusing on the surgery part, right? So what are the stages where surgery is recommended as the first line of treatment in cervical cancer?
So cervical cancer is basically staged clinically.
Okay.
And sometimes the doctors also take help of radiological information to stage cervical cancer.
Okay.
So commonly used staging is the FIGO staging.
Okay.
And if we see the FIGO staging, surgery usually is utilized in FIGO stage 1 and 2. 1 and 2A per se.
Okay.
And after that, usual modality of treatment is chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So
okay,
surgery is usually used only for early stages of cervical cancer, stage 1, and selected cases of stage 2.
Okay. Okay. And in terms of the post effects of surgery, what are the short term and long term side effects or impact because of surgery?
So firstly, I would like to tell you something a little bit about surgery. Surgery usually required for cervical cancer is a radical hysterectomy, which involves removal of the uterus, part of the vagina, the uterus along with the cervix, part of the vagina, and fibrofatty tissue lateral to the uterus, which is known as parametrium and paracolpos. So basically, this is the extent of surgery. Along with this, excision of uterus, cervix, part of vagina, parametrium, paracolpus. Another important thing of surgery is excision of the pelvic lymph nodes, where the cancer can spread. So it is basically removal of the uterus, cervix, part of vagina, and the pelvic lymph nodes. So basically, surgery done for cervical cancer is radical hysterectomy. And after the what the surgical extent is, we can come to the short-term and long-term side effects or complications of surgery.
Okay.
So usually in the short-term, complications expected as for other surgeries, important ones are wound infection and bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
Other important complications, I would say, is some of the patients post-surgery may have difficulty in micturation, that is difficulty in urination. They may need prolonged catheterization till their bladder function regains to normal. So they may require a prolonged catheterization, maybe 2 to 3 weeks also. Sometimes after surgery, a patient may develop rarely, but a serious complication is vesico-vaginal or a uretro-vaginal fistula where the urine leaks into the vagina. That is a worrisome complication which may occur rare. So basic important complications to remember are wound infection, bleeding, then vesico-vaginal or uretro-vaginal fistula. These are the urinary retention. So patients may require prolonged catheterization sometimes, usually maybe for a period of 2 to 3 weeks also.
Okay.
And if we look at the long-term complications, so long-term complications are especially because of pelvic lymph node dissection. So patients may have a collection of fluid into their abdomen, which we know as, which we call as lymphocysts, or patients may develop lymphedema, that is swelling of their lower limbs or thighs or the genital region. So these are basically because of excision of lymph nodes, patients may develop lymphedema or lymphocysts.
Okay.
And sometimes because of the surgery per se, patients may have complications like vaginal shortening in some cases.
Okay. So what are the lifestyle modifications? Because most of these impacts could be either in their control or no, right? It is very patient specific. But what are the lifestyle modifications that a patient can take to help minimize these complications at their end?
So usually, if we look at these complications, first and foremost, coming to urinary retention. So usually this problem will settle over a period of around 4 to 6 weeks. For initial few days, a prolonged catheterization may be required, but usually they will subside in 4 to 6 weeks. They may be advised pelvic muscle exercises to help gain good amount of control or bladder control and control during urination. So pelvic floor exercises are important. After this surgery, especially it would be told, because there would be an incision on the abdomen, they would be told not to lift heavy weights for at least a period of 3 months to 6 months. Another thing is important thing is they need to keep a watch over the symptoms, in the sense with period of time they should having a decrease in the symptoms likely to develop post-operatively, like the pain would subside. Sometimes they may have some amount of vaginal discharge that is also likely to subside. So all these symptoms of pain and vaginal discharge will usually subside in 3 weeks,
okay.
3 to 4 weeks. So these are important things. And in the long term, they need to keep a watch over whether they are developing edema or their limbs or in the perineal region, or are they developing any signs of any vaginal persistent clear watery fluid discharge per vaginum, which can be an indication of what I told, vesico-vaginal or uretro-vaginal fistula.
Yeah.
Or if there is lower limb or genital swelling, it can be lymphedema. And for these lymphedema cases, we can advise them to meet our physiotherapist who would guide them regarding massage therapy and other therapies to help decrease that lymphedema.
Yeah.
And if at all they have these symptoms of clear watery fluid discharge per vaginum, then we need to investigate for uretrovaginal or vesicovaginal fistula by radiological investigation.
Okay. And in terms of lymphedema, I think that is something that is seen in breast cancer as well, where there is lymph node dissection that takes place. Right. So how long does it take for lymphedema to come into existence? Like, how long does it take for the onset of lymphedema, typically after surgery?
Usually it is not that immediately a patient will notice, because slight amount of swelling, they may not notice it immediately.
Yeah.
But usually, and the amount of lymphedema also varies from person to person. So especially people who are obese are likely to have more amount of lymphedema.
Okay.
But usually it can vary from person to person, and usually a patient himself will notice that now there is some amount of swelling compared to what it was in the preoperative status, or they may have a unilateral more swelling on one side as compared to the other side.
Okay.
So maybe around 2-3 months down the line, they may start showing symptoms of, or they may notice changes in the girth of their thighs or okay. swelling over their thighs.
Okay. Okay.
Maybe 2 or 3 months maybe.
Okay. Okay. And in terms of the other treatment modalities, although we might not go in depth into the other options, but apart from surgery, what are the other treatments that are recommended for patients?
So apart from surgery, the other treatment modalities are radiation and chemotherapy. And in some cases, even after surgery, some patients may require radiation and chemotherapy. It depends on what is the histopathology report. Like I told you, surgery is radical hysterectomy. Whatever is excised during surgery is sent for pathology reporting. And based on that pathology report, we determine whether the patient needs further therapy, which is known as adjunct therapy, in the form of radiation or chemotherapy.
Okay.
So that is adjunct radiation or chemotherapy sometimes required after surgery. And patients who are usually not eligible for surgery are, in the sense, advanced stages, selected stage 2 and stage 3, stage 4 cases, are given the option of chemoradiotherapy. In the sense, radiation and chemotherapy is delivered to them. Chemotherapy basically is medicines usually delivered by the intravenous route, either weekly. Or various regimens are there, weekly, bi-weekly, but usual regimen is weekly. And radiation basically is exposing that particular tumor to radiation, and that usually goes on for a prolonged period of around 6 to 7 weeks. The patient has to lie down on a linear accelerator or a radiotherapy machine for around 5-10 minutes in a day. And that usually goes on for 6 to 7 weeks. Usually it is 5 days per week, and 2 days radiation is not delivered for 2 days in a week, but usually five consecutive days, Saturday, Sundays off, and 5 days radiation is delivered, and weekly chemo, once in a week during radiation, they receive chemotherapy.
Okay. Okay. And so moving on to the other aspect of patient's life. So after surgery, how will it impact a patient's sexual life in the long term? And also their chances of conceiving in the long term.
So, if the patient undergoes surgery for cervical cancer, basically normal reproduction is not possible because we are removing the uterus.
Okay.
We are removing the uterus along with the cervix and part of vagina. But there are certain fertility preserving surgeries now which can be offered to patients, especially radical trachelectomy, which is excision of the cervix and paracervical tissue while keeping the uterus and vagina intact.
Okay.
That is, the remnant uterus is again joined to the remnant vagina. So this surgery can be offered for patients who are willing who deserve to maintain fertility, and in selected cases, especially small tumors, surgery known as radical trachelectomy can be offered. So in this surgery, basically part of uterus is preserved, which is again joined to the vagina, and then patient can conceive and continue her pregnancy till full term in majority of the cases. So this option can be given to the patient in selected cases of radical trachelectomy, which is a kind of fertility preserving surgery.
Okay. So,
Premenopausal patients, if at all we are not doing a radical trachelectomy, but we are doing a radical hysterectomy, in such cases, we can preserve the ovaries. So, basically, source of hormones can be preserved. But then, if the patient is not a candidate for radical trachelectomy, then at least the ovaries can be preserved.
Okay. Okay. And so, have you come across cases in your practice where women had undergone this type of surgery and conceived at a later point?
So, in my practice, I haven't come across a patient who has been a candidate for radical trachelectomy per se, because Indian scenario is a little adverse per se, because majority of the patient present in advanced stages, or they tend to delay, the presentation is delayed. So majority of the cases are not candidates for radical trachelectomy. Majority of the patients are even not candidates for surgery, because majority of the times they present in stage 3 and stage 4, when the only option left is chemotherapy and radiotherapy.
Okay.
But it is a documented procedure, and it has been shown in studies, in scientific literature has been published, that this can be offered to the patient.
Okay. Perfect. So I think that completes all the questions pertaining to surgery that we had, but also in terms of the long-term lifestyle modifications, right? For the patients to reduce the risk of recurrence and living a cancer-free lifestyle, are there some tips that you'd want to give to patients?
So first of all, for patients who have completed treatment for cervical cancer, I would suggest that it is important for them to maintain a regular follow-up with their oncologist, so that recurrences are diagnosed at an early stage and therapy can be initiated even for recurrences with an attempt to cure them again, or at least to mitigate the symptoms and severity of the disease. So regular follow-up is important for cases of cervical cancer who have completed treatment. And in regular follow-up, it's not just to identify recurrences, but we can also help them mitigate the side effects of therapy. So that is one thing. And it is also important that if at all the patient has been a tobacco addict, it is important that we give them an advice for tobacco and smoking cessation, so as to decrease their risk for recurrence. Now, coming to general population per se, who have never been diagnosed with cancer, it is important that we look after 3-4 important things. First and foremost is tackling HPV. So now we have what? Screening as an important modality to detect cancer at early stages and achieve good cure rates. Screening, as I told you, Pap smear screening once in 3 years starting from the age of 21, or co-testing, that is Pap smear along with HPV testing, that is once in 5 years, should be followed. Another thing is, now HPV vaccine is available, a vaccine which targets high-risk HPV types. So HPV vaccine can be administered, especially it is recommended starting from the age of 9 years. And it is usually 2 dose or 3 dose of vaccines, usually on first vaccine, then at 1 month, and then at 6 months. So that vaccine provides good amount of protection from cervical cancer, and it is very safe. Minimal side effects of the vaccine given intramuscularly starting from the age of 9 years. Usually 3 doses or 2 doses, depending on what age they take the vaccine. So these are important things: screening, vaccination. Then important thing is smoking cessation or tobacco de-addiction. And another important thing is practicing safe sex, like using barrier contraceptives, which will help prevent HPV transmission by the sexual route. So barrier contraceptives like condoms will help prevent sexually transmission of the HPV virus.
Okay, perfect. And I think with that, Dr. Parag, we've completed all the questions that we had planned for the session today. I'd like to conclude the session by saying that you have been very concise and precise with all the answers. And I'm sure people watching this will find this information very useful. So thank you so much for taking time off and agreeing to do this session with us. Thank you.